the World Cup of 2007. Australia are the World Cup champions of 1999. What a victory for the Sri Lankans. A fantastic
to everyone, another exciting episode of Match Point by Dr. Adnan, and we are on the day number 22 and the championship match. So you saw the Vancouver Knights with the flying colors beat Cricket West Indies B team, which was initially the team to beat in the West Indies, and they lifted the championship in the stride. Two matches were affected by the rain, and the important match of the David Warner's team, the Winnipeg Hawks, their match suffered because of the rain, because there was no extra cover. But right now, I'm having my very special extra cover by his man, Mike Hisman. Hello, Mikey.
Hello, Doc. Nice to chat to you.
So, such a nice and a pleasure to see you in the box. Since I was in the medical school and was watching, the dish was there, and newly the cricket was introduced to the television circuits, there was only one voice. Mike Hisman, extra cover. So we are having over a very special extra cover. Mike Hisman. Mike, how are you?
I'm good, all good. And I'm delighted that we had a terrific turnout today and a nice game. It was just a little unfortunate that Windy's B didn't quite come up to scratch, because they were so good throughout the tournament. But overall, I think the tournament was terrific. You know, there's always one or two little things you need to iron out for the next one, but it was thoroughly enjoyable from my perspective. I hope also from yours.
Yep. And Mike, you are having a terrific and absolute experience of covering the cricket around the globe professionally. We people are still learning from you guys. So when you came over here, obviously there are a lot of teething factors and a lot of problems are coming, huge grounds. So what was the main issue you thought that it should be improved when league comes to the next year to the same grounds?
I think undoubtedly the one thing that that stands out is we need to get more consistent pitches. The pitch we played on the last three games was really good. That was nice. We also had three really good days right at the start of the tournament. Just a couple of tracks in the middle a little bit too dry. But we've got to understand also that 90% of the ground staff working here are volunteers. When we did have the rain, it was amazing how many people came out and got involved and tried to get things going, which is terrific to see all the locals getting stuck in. In fact, the guy who was doing most of the work, Mahan, as the head groundsman out there instructing everyone, he's actually the president of the Maple Leaf Cricket Club. So there he was in his short and his hat and his ripped t-shirt, and he was rolled up his sleeves and got stuck in. So it was just really good to see the team effort from people who really wanted to make it happen when it perhaps wasn't as good as it should have been.
And about the pitch, as you talked about the pitch, I was listening for the Tom Moody, the losing coach, and they remained fifth in the tournament. Yeah. Montreal Tigers, they couldn't perform well in spite of having the Latish Malinga, the deadly Yorkers. So he was very unhappy. Moody was saying uneven bounce coming directly deadly at the faces of the batsmen. But we saw Justin Greaves, Nicholas Puran. Puran I have seen, actually. I have never seen the Rutherford. But how
was that knock?
Wow, Decabo!
That was the knock of the tournament by a mile. It was 136, not out, I think, of 66 balls.
Yes.
And importantly, steered him home. I mean, that's he didn't get out, didn't give it to someone else. He did the job himself and steered him home. Yeah. That was head and shoulders above anyone else.
So, Mikey, my point was this. When the Moody's batsman or the other batsman, Toronto National, Steve Smith, the Australian skipper and the David Warner, they are even struggling. How come these new guys, coming coming on the same Viri pitch. They made the thing so easy in this tournament. Puran, Fabius Allen, Justin Greaves, although Justin is having experience of playing cricket in the English conditions also, but even then, this was a new pitch for them.
It's really simple, and Chris Gayle said it at the presentation one day, I remember. David Warner also said it at the presentation as well. He said these young Windies B-boys, they played the ball. They didn't play the man, they didn't play the conditions, they played the ball. They just ignored anything that was going on. We're fronted up, ready to face the next delivery. So they weren't worried about anything. I mean, when you get a pitch that does the odd little strange thing, and let's be totally honest, we all realise there's work to be done on the surface, and next time that's going to be improved. But when you get this mentality in the change room, the players start complaining about the pitch, it doesn't do any good at all. It just spreads like wildfire. Guys get negative, and you can see the Windies B didn't. And I think they showed some of these old guys a little bit of a lesson. You're saying Tom Moody got a bit moody about it? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. Okay. Tom Moody, but Waqar Yunus also told, but he said just praise for these guys who are playing brilliantly, and we have to come next time with a better preparation. So Mikey, you covering cricket for the 3 decades now, the most experienced man in front of the TV and for the anchor role as a commentator, as a chief commentator. Your cricket when you were covering, and now the cricket when Rutherford and these guys hitting 200 in less than 20 overs. Yep. So how you compare that mighty cricket of Clive Lloyd and Viv Richards when there is a supremacy of them, the Windies in the 70s and 80s, and then shift of power towards the Australia in the late 90s and the one-man show of scientific cricket, and now again cricket evenly distributed among all those. So how you saw from your eyes this shift of power?
You know, I love T20 cricket. It's very, I love Test cricket. Test cricket's right up there as my favourite. But I'm telling you right now, T20 is just that much behind. I absolutely love T20. And I guess the reason for that is I like the freewheeling of T20 cricket. I like the fact that one player can dominate a game. I'm always watching, when I'm commentating on a T20 game, I'm always watching a couple of players, not necessarily the ones who get the most wickets or the most that get the most runs. I'm looking for the player that affects an outcome. I'll give you an example. If Andre Russell gets dismissed with 5 overs to go, whoever got him out, providing it was a good ball, has affected that innings, because Andre Russell can be unbelievable in the last 5 overs. So they're my guys I like to watch. I think a lot of people sit back these days, watch T20 cricket, and they sort of just let it unfold in front of them. I mean, there's a real science to it these days. You can't overthink it. Let's not get that wrong. You can't overthink it. And as a doctor, you've studied, I'm sure, and you've seen all that. But those guys who don't get too confused, stick with some serious basics and have some variety when they're bowling. Batsmen have outpaced the bowlers in their improvement. There's no doubt about that. But I think there's so many little tricks around the place, tricks of the trade in T20. But I'd like the viewers to concentrate on guys who affect outcomes. That's really important for me. And as far as guys in different eras, isn't it nice to sit back and dream and just think what a Viv Richards could have done, what a Brian Lara could have done, what a David Gower could have done, the way he played for England when he was captain, and before him, both of them, some of these guys. I mean, some of the Australians, of course, and the great team that the Australian had, what a shame Warne would have done in 4 overs. Well, that's half the fun, I think. It's hard to compare. I would have loved to have seen a whole bunch of those guys play T20 cricket, but unfortunately they didn't.
And Mikey, one of my friend, Danny Morrison.
Yep.
Where is Danny Morrison? We are missing him. The flying colors and not the anchor, but the sporting colorful commentator. Yep. Where is Danny? Is he coming next season?
I don't know. He at the moment he's busy in the Caribbean. He's working on that series, the West Indies versus Bangladesh. He'll be sticking his hand up, I'm sure, to come. So we'll get him here.
And Mikey, who is your favourite commentator? You are in the hearts of so many cricket lovers, but who is Mike Hazeman's favourite commentator?
I had the great pleasure during the 2003 World Cup of anchoring that broadcast. It was in South Africa, anchoring the final as well. And I commentated with Richie Benaud.
Oh, wow.
Say no more. Does it get any better than that? Different styles. I got a different style from Richie, but it was just a delight to sit next to him after all the years I'd heard, and the beige jacket, just to sit next to him and see him go about his work and listen and hang off every word that he said.
The great Richie Benaud, rest in peace. The very tough time for the Australia. First they lost the son of cricket, their son, and then in between the World Cup and then losing their father. What a sad days of cricket those days.
Yeah.
So before leaving you, I just want to ask you final two questions.
Yep.
That when New Zealand will win the World Cup?
Never.
When South Africa will win? When South Africa will win the knockout game?
Never. Any more questions?
When Pakistan will beat India in the World Cup?
Please.
I'd like to see a tie. But that's not sitting on the fence, is it? I commentated on that game 2003. Remember that game when Sachin was uppercutting Shoaib Akhtar?
Oh, yes, Sachin yes,
got,
yes.
Did he get 98? I can't remember. It was Shoaib Akhtar was at Super Small Park. He was running in and bowling a million miles an hour. And Sachin was taking one.
Yeah, correct. 2003 World Cup. We lost the game.
Had the plane flying over. It was brilliant. It was wonderful to be involved in that environment.
Viv Richards, Alan Border, Alan Lamb, Sunil Gavaskar, Javed Miadad, Mike Hazeman pick. For the test match.
Viv Richards.
Viv Richards. Brian Lara or Sachin Tendulkar, your pick?
Brian Lara. Most entertaining, Brian Lara. Viv's the best I've seen. Brian's the most entertaining.
Mikey,
who's the best bowler? Ask me who's the best bowler I've seen.
Yes, best bowler ever faced.
Dennis Lilly. Best I've seen. I faced him just when he was at the end of his career, so he wasn't lightning fast then, but when he was a tearaway quick.
And if you compare with the Jeff Thompson, Jeffrey?
Faced Tomo as well. He was sharp and what a character. But no, Lilly was the best of them all.
Mike Hazeman has a chance to face Shoaib Akhtar or Batley. Whom he will avoid?
Akhtar.
The same question which David Warner answered. Yup. So thank you so much, Mikey, for your valuable time. Thank you so much and wish to see you in the next upcoming league when the next year cricket will be here and hope to catch you everywhere. What a terrific stance and what a terrific way to present and bringing the commentary to us. Thank you so much.
Terrific, Doc. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you so much. This was Mike Hazeman and next time when I will come, we will come with a new superstar and we will take you to the new heights of cricket. So last news from here, the Global T20 Canada, the first ever tournament of its own kind. Vancouver Knights are known to be the first ever champions on this soil in the North America. And hope when we will catch you next time, we will see a new winner. Till then, take care and bye-bye.
The man broke up, that is Australia's joy, and England.